So you made your big debut by getting slapped in the hold up, time out. You made your big debut by getting slapped in the you know where. That's probably a little bit more proper to say. So you got uppercutted by, it was like a half pound bass too.
Yeah, something so stupid. So let me think. That was probably in July, about 2 years ago. And I uploaded it. I was like, oh, Lord, you know, look how funny this is. Ha ha. Uploaded it. Got no, like, everybody was like, oh, ha ha. And that was it. Well, you know, everybody does a TikTok thing. People get, like, TikTok famous and everything. So I was like, well, there's a TikTok editor where you can edit videos and you can add sounds. And I was half asleep one morning, and it was right before work. I was like, oh, let me just make a video, and made it, uploaded it. Didn't check my phone from 8 in the morning till, I don't know, about 5 o'clock in the evening. What? I checked my TikTok was 99 plus notifications, and it was already at like over almost, I think it was at a million. I think it was already at a million just in that short a period of time. It was at 2 million by the next day. Ended up going to 26 million within a week.
Bruh.
And multiple people were stealing it. It was 100,000 views here, 100 million views there, 50 million on this site, 80 million on this. So what I did is I said, you know what? I should have sold that immediately. And then I would have made money on it. But I waited too late. I mean, I've sold it to Viral Hog, and I get 50% royalties on it. So every month it's like you're getting $87 to this month. I'm like, oh, cool. Oh, you're getting $200 this month. Oh, cool. I don't even look at it. They just email me and say, hey, this is being deposited in your PayPal just for getting slapped in the
You know what, by a fish.
Yeah. And everybody thought it was hilarious. And I was like, yeah, I mean, it wasn't really. I didn't even laugh. The guy on the back of the boat didn't even laugh. He just went, oh. And we kept fishing.
Yeah.
You know,
that's usually how that kind of stuff is. The crazy moments, especially when you're someone like me and you, that happen.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of times we're so used to it, it doesn't really faze us a whole lot. We're used to getting slapped in the you know what by a fish, and so it's like when it happens, you're like, "Dude, dear God, you're not thinking about making $200 and something off PayPal this month or getting that coming through from that." You're just like, "I just got freaking fish slime on me, and now I got a stomach ache. Got a vacuum on my stomach is what it feels like." Oh, well, look,
hit me.
Introduce yourself. Go ahead and tell me. I told you I'm already super excited, but let everyone know who you are.
Well, I'm Short DeCourt, Blake DeCourt. Everybody knows me by Short DeCourt. If you know any type of fishing locally, I replace boat carpets, Short DeCourt marine carpet. Kind of known around the area for that mainly. And then Bussy Break Blake is. Somebody gave me that nickname a long time ago because I stayed on Bussy Break for a while trying to learn it. And there's like, well, there goes Bussy Break Blake. I said, hey, that's kind of corny, but I'll take it.
Look, keep the PayPal royalties coming. It don't matter what they call you. Yeah. Well, I'm excited here. Again, I told you the other day, this is the first time that we've like officially met. Like, I know we kept up with each other. Like you were, how old are you?
How old am I? 35.
35. Okay. Yeah. I'm 30. So, I know there's a little bit of age difference between high school and, but I remember you a little bit from there and then just mutual friends and then also jiu-jitsu. I don't train near as much as I used to. And, you could tell I don't have any black eyes and you do. So you can tell who's actually in there rolling. But, I've known you, Nick, my brother-in-law, I know y'all are pals and talking stuff.
Yeah. Me and Nick strangled each other a few times.
Yeah.
I miss that guy.
Dude, Nick's awesome. Nick, he's super awesome. I was hoping he'd be here for this one and we'd kind of three-way it and have a good old time and cut up, talk fishing and everything. But
well, call him, say, hey, we are live.
He knows we're doing it. He'd probably decline the call. He's like, nope, I'm on a dozer or a backhoe right now. Y'all got it. Yeah. You got it. But no, I'm glad you're here. I told you, it's like we're going to talk hunting, fishing, kind of talk a little bit of it all. But jiu-jitsu, are you a black belt yet?
No, I'm a dirty old brown belt. It's turning white.
So how long have you been there? I bet if I called Chris Hill and asked him, hey, Blake, when was he due for a black belt? He'd probably say long overdue.
Well, I'll just say this. A belt only covers about 2 inches of your butt.
Yeah.
So, I mean, dude, I've trained with many, 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 many people. I've been training for probably 17, 18 years now. That's not even including my whole beginning part of martial arts. I mean, right. I was always in some type of martial art, but I'm counting jiu-jitsu, like Gracie jiu-jitsu.
The real martial arts.
I ain't gonna say that. I mean, there every martial art has its place.
Yeah, for sure.
But you know, jiu-jitsu tells the truth.
Yeah.
It is the truth. I mean, Nick will even tell you.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like, I mean, you go take the somebody that's on the street, the biggest, baddest dude on the street, strong, somebody that nobody could mess with. Go put them in a jiu-jitsu gym and take a computer geek that's 130 pounds soaking wet.
Or a 110 pound girl, like a.
Yes.
That's 14 years old.
Yes.
So. She will, it don't matter the size you have. If she knows it mm-hmm. and you don't, which I didn't my first day. Your boy got wrapped up.
Really?
She was 14 years old, maybe 105, 110 pounds.
I got an idea who it is.
Who
done it?
Yeah. Bella was her name, I think.
Bella. Okay.
From Monroe.
I was thinking another person.
So y'all actually had a lady the very first time Chris finally is like, dude, you and Nick, y'all got to come to jiu-jitsu. Like, you mm-hmm. got to come. And I was like, dude, I don't have time. Like, I know that's an excuse, and it is. And I could make time if I really wanted to, but. I don't want to. Like, I don't want to. In the evening time, if I get off and I'm through with all the video stuff and everything else I'm doing, I want to go home and chill with my family.
Yes.
I don't want to go to the gym at 6:30 or whatever. He's like, we have a 5 a.m. class. Come in the morning. I'm like, okay. So
I have to sleep.
Yeah, I was like, so me and Nick went that morning. It was no-gi. And so this was over 2 years ago. We went, and you can adjust however you want to. You're good at all moves. Yeah, you can chop it.
I feel like I'm looking at it over my eyes like this.
You probably are. Oh, short to court coming in hot, baby. All right,
let me lean up a little bit because he's sitting up.
But
there we go.
But no, so me and Nick, we went, and that next morning, and the girl there, you wouldn't know her. She was probably my age, maybe a little bit older, as a lady, mm-hmm. Redheaded lady, about this. I mean, she was small, real small. I don't remember her name. I want to call her maybe Amy or something. It's been a few years ago. I don't remember. But
maybe.
Anyhow, she does jiu-jitsu at Crown Gracie in West Monroe, or at least did then, and has been rolling and training for a while.
Really?
Well, she was the first one. Of course, you know, I don't know if you remember, but you deal and you train enough new people. When you go in for the very first day, like you get somebody in on the first day, they don't have a clue what they're doing. Like right now, if me and you, again, you would strangle me. But right now, if you're like, hey, let's move the table. Let's show these guys what rolling is. I'm not going to be able to handle you, but you're going to know, okay, this guy, like, he may only be a one-stripe white belt, but, like, he at least knows what an elbow escape is. Like, there's a few things. He knows the concept of rolling. Yeah. When you're brand new, you don't. You're like, what do I do with my hands? You have no clue. You know, you just don't know. And so.
Well, I actually teach the beginner class. I've been teaching the white belt class for a little over a year. I don't know. Time runs together. I was blessed with the ability to instruct and use the correct terminology where somebody brand new can actually understand it.
Yeah.
Sometimes you get a, let's just say a real high level coach. They don't know how to break it down to the beginner sometimes because they're just speaking a different language.
Right. You need like a jiu-jitsu for dummies is really what you need because it's so foreign. Like you don't know what that stuff is. And also if you explain something to me of what it is, I have no idea how to make my body do that.
Yeah.
No clue. And so being able to break
it down.
That's
why we slow it way down. You got to learn to crawl before you stand.
Yeah.
Once you learn how to stand, then you got to learn how to step. Once you learn how to step, then you can walk. Once you walk, you can jog. And once you jog, you can run.
Yeah.
So it's, and you see all those steps we were talking about?
Yeah.
That's a lot of steps that you got to take. Most people will say, you got to learn how to walk before you run. Boy, you just forgot the whole, you know, you got to crawl first.
Yeah.
You know, so it's a. It's literally broke down because I want the white belts that I teach, I want to bring them up with solid basics, solid basics, because I was a white belt once and man, I learned things wrong. Try to go back and relearn something right after your body's used to bad habits.
Yeah.
That's pretty tough.
Well, and like, so one thing I can speak directly on that is archery. Like that's something you talked about the other day is like going out and shooting. I went and even at early, I've been shooting a bow forever, but up until probably 5 years ago, 2020. Yeah. So going on 4.5, almost 5 years ago, when Michael and Richard went down to Spotted Dog from the other place, that is when I really started taking it serious. And like, I was like, okay, I don't want to just go out there and be able to go and shoot something like this big at 30 yards or be able to kill a deer at 20 yards or whatever. Like I like shooting 40 yards. Like I always had a, like a 4 or 5 pin sight. And so it's like, I want to be able to go and shoot 50 yards for fun or whatever. And if I get good at 50 yards or I can hit a target at 50 yards, that'll help me kill a deer at 20 yards or whatever.
Yeah.
Going and I realized pretty quick, everything I learned, I mean, you learn the fundamentals and the basics of it, but it's kind of like riding a bike or as you're talking about even doing jiu-jitsu or whatever, it's kind of like you know just enough of the basics to kind of get you through, but then like really getting to that next step, you got to forget a lot of the other stuff that you learned and force yourself into new habits. And it's tough. Yeah. Golf is the same thing. Oh, a lot of people here listen to golf. Like, do you
golfed for a long time with my dad. And I've unfortunately haven't been able to go. He's got Parkinson's right now and we haven't been able to go because of that. But golf, oh man. Don't grow muscles and think you're going to hit the ball straight no more.
No, it's probably going to be worse.
I got the best slice in the game. I can be on hole one and probably make it on the green on hole seven over there. It's whoosh.
Yeah. So you got to relearn new stuff. And but it's the same with archery and everything else. It's all the same. But one thing that I have figured out is going and getting more efficient, not saying efficient, getting more efficient on the small things in archery has helped me a bow hunter. I've always been, now don't get me wrong, remember the Luke Bryan video of him on Buck Commander? He shot that deer. He's like, oh my God, oh my God.
Is he down?
Is he down? Is you know, like down? That. Like, oh my God. Yeah. So like, that's absolutely.
Sorry, Luke Bryan.
Sorry. Yeah, sorry. He's not listening. I don't know. He actually might. He actually might.
I got a friend that's friends with him.
Yeah.
Send it to him.
Yeah. Jordan, if you're watching this, send to Luke. But, like that. It's awesome to get that excited, and you want that out of somebody. Like, they don't have to go completely wild like that, but you want people to get excited and nervous and just want to throw up or whatever. Yeah. But once I started going and getting more efficient in my draw and pulling through the shot, and I didn't even know, used to not know what that was. I would just, as soon as a deer went behind a tree, I'd pull back real quick. And I may or may not have been anchored. I was shooting a wrist strap at the time. So, like, maybe that knuckle is behind my ear. Maybe, I don't know. Yeah. I just pull back just real quick. Slow. And then it's like, boom, just pull the trigger as fast as I could on that release and hope I hit my shot. And I miss and wounded most of the time. Oh. And so, like just as a kid, I did it all the time. Yeah. Even on some big deer, I messed up. But once I started going and kind of changed up some of the gear and really kind of figured out what I liked and what suited, what was the hardest for me to get, that's what I stuck with when it came to gear. And so like the button release, the UV button, I shoot it. And try a hinge a little bit. I haven't gotten the hinge down pat. I shoot that button like a handheld release. I shoot it like a hinge release or back tension, but it's still not the same. But
I got an old Scott trigger.
Yeah, that's great.
I just got the basic.
What, like a little goose or something?
Yep.
Yeah, and just there's nothing wrong with that. Some of the best people in the world still shoot that. For me, it's like I had a cinder block on. I don't even know if I used to shoot stabilizers. I had like the little short, like a little stabby, like limb saver, you know, or whatever. Yeah. Something like
20,
that. But
20 bucks.
Yeah, 20 bucks from Walmart, you know, or go to Spotted Dog, $20 or whatever. But like once I stepped up to like shooting like actual stabilizing bars on the front and back, I felt like on that release, and this was just a way for me to completely forget all that and go to a new release to try to get out of it. And it did work. It doesn't work for everybody. But that, I would go and I'd draw back and it felt like I had a cinder block or two cinder blocks on my front bar of my bow and I could not get my pin up to the target. Like I just went through a phase of target panic and I just couldn't do it. And so anyhow, it was aggravating. And so I was like, all right, I'm going to go the easy way out, go to a handheld release, which does not fix things. It got worse, but I've learned through it and that's what it is.
Well, see, that's where I'm at. As a bow hunter, I'm a white belt bow hunter. I'm a white belt in bow hunting. I've never pulled back on a deer.
Really?
With a bow. I've watched them.
You've also just started. Didn't you say the other day you just started?
About 2 years ago. I got me a Matthews Phase 4. At the time, that was the new model then.
I have one now. Incredible bow.
And let a butt of mine, Lathan, you know, he built it. And don't have anything extravagant. Got a CBE 3 pin. I'm trying to think what else. I mean, that's pretty much it. It's
you don't need a whole lot on that bow. No, you can, no but stabilizer. You don't need it.
I do have a little Tacticam, a little hollow Tacticam thing, just in case. In case I want to press record.
Yeah.
I may take that off, but I would hope that I can record some of my hunts through that thing because it's got a little bit of zoom. And I've watched deer, but they were coming out too late, and I couldn't get out of the stand. I was literally in a pine tree 12 to 15 foot up, actually not very high because of the type of cover that I had.
Yeah.
If I would have went 15, 17, I would have been out of the cover.
Yeah, been up in the open.
So I went to about 12, 13, had perfect cover.
Yeah.
That way, them looking up at me, they have to look through bushes, but I can see straight. It was just perfect spot. And had a big old, I'm talking about huge. He was only 8 points, and he's about 3.5 years old, but I was going to send him a deer head. And, but that dude was smart. He come out and he bedded down right below my tree, laid down, and I had a camera. I had a tactic cam right below on the bottom of my tree. So I have my phone in my pouch, and it's zip, zip, and it's like getting dark. I said, I can't get down. I would look, and the deer is laying down looking.
Did you not know it was that deer? Oh, okay.
I could look down, but I didn't want to move. And he would bed down right here, and then a small doe would come over here and bed down. There was about 6 to 8 deer all under me. I was in their bedding area.
Mm.
Scent perfect. Didn't smell me because they were smelling all the peanut butter rice bran. But I sat there and I was like, man, I could have pulled. I could have, but it just wasn't right.
Yeah.
You know, I felt like, I guess it was kind of nervous. Like, I can't move. I can't get my bow.
Mm-hmm.
And I would have my bow like right here on my left knee. But even if I moved my hand, I felt like it was going to
hear you.
I was too close.
Yeah.
And ended up stop hunting that deer. And then I sat in a stand and had him walk under me, but wasn't nothing I wanted to, shoot.
You need to kill your doe.
I know that's what they say, but
you just
need to do it.
Just need to go ahead and bloody up an arrow. Go ahead and get you a doe. Cause I'm telling you, once you draw back on them, it's completely different.
Yeah.
Completely different.
Yeah. And I need to get that experience. And that's what I was telling a bud of mine on the way up here. We were talking about it. And I was like, I'm going to be picky what I shoot at this year. And he kind of told me the same things. Like, man, you need to get on the board with your bow. I was like, I will. But then I was so used to this past year just watching them.
Yeah.
Just getting my phone out, recording them,
And that's fun too.
Yeah.
But like you said, when you draw back on one, it's a different, yes.
Yeah.
Did I hit him?
Yeah. And that's the thing about drawing back on one. Like you mentioned a minute ago, you want to get out in the distance. So you like shooting long distance.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know when I was shooting bows, how confident I was in my shots? Let's just say confidence at 20, 30 to 40.
Yeah.
Or we'll just say 20 to 35 yards. Being super confident, and that's a close range, but that's the most common range you're going to see a deer. Rarely will you shoot a deer over, 45, 50,
especially
60.
Around here.
Like, yeah. Because you're going to have so much. You may be able to see the deer, but there's limbs going to be in the way.
Multiple trees, limbs. Yeah.
So it's like I started noticing I got better whenever I started making longer shots.
Mm-hmm.
So I always started at 20. Put one, a couple there, go to 30, go to 40. Now, I only got a 3-pin sight, so I got 20, 30, 40. I don't add a 50.
Yeah.
But I found out on my CBE, if I'm level with the bottom of the round sight, that's
60?
That's my 50.
You're 50, okay.
So if I'm at here's there, I just raise it up.
Yeah.
50, I was hitting it right in the heart on a deer target.
Nice.
I guess the 3D shooters or whatever. Now, I'm not saying I was a perfect shot, but if I was placing them like that at 50 and grouping them, then I would walk back up to like 25 or 30. And it was just
so easy.
Because you were so used to long shots.
Yeah.
And my confidence at closer shots, I got better because I was shooting longer.
Yeah.
It's kind of like lifting weights. I'm an old power lifter. I used to bodybuild. So if you want to get your bench press max up, let's just say, I don't know. Let's just use 315. That's the glorified weight. 3 plates, right? So if you're under 315 and you do it 5 times. Okay, 5 times. Put it up. Do it another 5 times. Well, that's what your body is thinking right now. I got 315 right here. I'm doing it 5 times. How about next time you warm up and you go to 315, you do it once. Go up to your max. Like literally, like say if your max is 405. Walk up to 405, do your max, and then drop it back down real quick. You're going to be repping 315 more than 5 times because your body's used to that heavier weight. It's kind of like you get it on your arms, and then when you grab 315, you're like, oh, this is light. Well, you just held 405.
Yeah.
So it's a way to kind of trick your mind, I guess,
because
that's what I used to do. I used to like max out one rep every day before on bench press days.
Yeah.
Just so I could be like, okay, now
I got it. Now let's go to the other stuff and it'll be easier for you.
Yeah, now let's go do our reps. And it's like throwing it to the ceiling and back.
Yeah. And it is the same with archery, like the total archery challenge stuff. It's so much. Have you heard of that? The total archery challenge?
I've heard of it.
TAC events. They have them in Broken Bow. They just started years ago, having it in Broken Bow. It's all 3.5 hour drive from here. It's not bad. It is so much fun. Like, you're liable to go out there and it may be a moose target at 120 yards that you're having to shoot, or a bedded elk at 111, or it could be a deer at 30. Like, so you essentially, you're going and you're walking this course, out in the, I don't remember the name of the Beaver's Bend park, state park. And so you're just going and walking these trails, and there's cones and like flaggings of where you need to go. And it's safe. Like, everybody has tee times, and that way, like, the person ahead of you, they have more than enough time. No matter what, they have more than enough time to go shoot several targets. And so when you're shooting this way, they're already over here or over there. You're not shooting towards anybody. It's really, really, thousands and thousands of people shoot them. Dang. Nobody's gotten hurt. But
110?
Oh, dude, there's Bigfoot, like a big life size. I say life size, if he was real. I don't know. Do you believe? Do you believe in Bigfoot?
I've seen some things. You say, I've trained with a Bigfoot before.
Yeah, I know. Somebody as bad as Bigfoot, but
I've trained with somebody as hairy as Bigfoot. I'll tell you that much.
Dang, you better keep your mouth closed. Don't leave them lips open.
Yeah,
but yeah, I mean, you're shooting a 9-foot solid, like lime green Bigfoot target. It's knock on archery. John Dudley is the one who has it, but it's a Bigfoot target that you're shooting at least 120 yards. I mean, it'll be 120 to 130 yards that you're shooting, and it has a sticker right here in the middle that you're trying to go and hit, and it's awesome.
But, now, that sounds pretty fun. I would like to do that, but explain to me how, you know, I got 3-pin sight. I'm not going to be taking my 3-pin sight out there. And you have a 5-pin?
I have, on most of my bows, I have a 2-pin sight. I have one bow, I have a 3-pin, but it's adjustable. It has a dial on it.
Oh,
and
I so, got you.
So like my Phase 4, I have a Phase 4 33. Mm-hmm. And I'll run the same thing on my new Hoyt that I get this year, but probably the exact same sight, but it's a Spot Hog Fast Eddy XL is what I run.
Yeah, I've seen those.
Yep, and so it's got like the long bar on it, and you can adjust it wherever you want. But the sight housing is as small as the top of that monster can. I guess like the scope is pretty small and has 2 pins. So like yours come out like this, like horizontal pins. This has one vertical post that comes up and has a pin on top and a pin on bottom.
Yeah.
And so you go and you sight it in at 20 yards and you put your sight tape on there, like your adjustment tape. And it's essentially on zero. It's bottomed out. It's on zero. Then you shoot at 30, sight it in, but you don't do anything. You just kind of rotate it and you shoot all the way back to 60. Once you get to 60, your sight tape, like your, because you have your dial and it may have a notifier, or it may, the indicator on it, it may be set to, or maybe on 17. Mm-hmm. Or like my case now, I'm on sight tape 21. I think I'm on 20 or 21 on my Phase 4. Anyhow, whatever it is, 20 or 21, you know that, okay, I'm 20 yards is on zero on the tape, 60 yards is on 21. And so you can go and pull sight tape 21. Line it up, put it on there, and you got from everywhere from 20 yards all the way out to 120 yards.
See, that's pretty cool. That's something that I don't have any experience in. Yeah. That would be cool.
It's legit. So then again, you can just go and you can just like range something at 42 yards, and that's how I hunt if you have time. You range it at 42, and then you just move your dial to 42. But it also, it's 20 yards and 37 is where my 2 pins are. Yeah. So I can go and shoot at 20 yards or almost 40 yards. And if I need to split the difference, which I've had to do, if I got a deer that he's 20, 21 yards and something happens and a buck or doe jumps or they walk off and they're not, I don't have another shot, I'm not going to let down. I know that roughly just by ranging stuff and knowing the area I'm hunting, I know roughly they're going to be 30, 35 yards. So I know how to split the difference on the pins. This just comes with shooting. Yeah. I'm not great at it, but just
And that's the experience that I'll have to get, you know, like one of my bow stands, they come out at 20 to 25. That's usually what they come out with. Yeah. I got a pin at 20.
Yeah.
I got a pin at 30. I'm just going to
split the difference.
Yeah, just split the difference. Yeah. But, you know, there's going to be a time where I'm like, I'm unsure how far it is. Mm-hmm. I don't have time to range it. It'll be a guesstimate.
Yeah.
But you hit the lungs. I mean, you're there.
Well, another thing you got to think, we've all seen the videos of the does that when people draw back and like this is their line, like this is their back, and you shoot. Yeah. And they just drop like a foot, 10 inches, something crazy. Yeah. And you're like, how did they just
shoot
duck a two?
Their head up,
Yeah.
Shoot them when their head's up.
Because if their head is up,
they're not loaded.
They're not loaded. Yeah. They're still, I've still had them duck arrows.
Yeah.
And probably because I was aiming too high, but they absolutely will still duck a good bit.
Yeah.
When you go and on, like I film most of my hunts on a GH5, like it's pretty durable. It does plenty good enough, and I don't have to take any, like one of the big cameras, anything like you're seeing here. It's $800 camera versus what those are. But regardless, I can go and take that GH5. It shoots 180 frames, so really, really slow-mo. And I'm telling you, even at 20 yards shooting 290 feet per second or right there at it, they will still duck multiple inches, even at 20 yards.
Telling like you. Deer are amazing.
Dude, they are. But yeah, I think with their head up, I think you wanna try to shoot them with if you're thinking on that and that's on your mind, you're probably better off shooting that with their head up.
And yeah. I watched a video the other day on Facebook and it showed a doe that was eating with his head down. And you could hear it, pow, and because the head was down, she just loaded up. Literally, her belly touched the ground and then took off to the right. And then it had a video of a buck. Same thing, about the same distance. Head was up. He looked, and doom. And he still dropped.
Yeah.
But by the time he dropped, the arrow was already through in his target. So it dropped this much compared to the doe dropping. Like, literally. Yeah. So I was like, man, that's pretty interesting stuff. That's stuff I need to know.
Yeah.
You know?
And that's the only, you learn that by drawing back and shooting some of the does, which you're going to do this season. That's how you learn that, because you don't know. Like, that's another big reason to go and shoot bows to get the practice in. Now, a buck, I'm not saying a buck won't jump as much as a doe or drop as much as a doe, but man, these Louisiana does we have, they've been shot at 15 times so far this season, you know. It's summertime, they've still been shot at, you know, from people around here. Like, people never stop, these rednecks.
But they still
shoot them. But going and drawing back and kind of getting in your routine of, you know, because this can be tough. As stout as you are, I mean, your arms are as big as my waist, but still going and a deer walking behind a tree and you start getting drawn back and then you have to hold it for a second. That's happened before, and that's really tough. So learning like when to draw so you don't get in that position. That's another thing.
Luckily, I got 85% let off, thank goodness, because on the phase four, and I have practiced that, I would draw back, look off, you know, just take my mind off of it.
Yeah.
And then just not really counting, just be like, okay, I feel a little fatigued now. Then I'll aim on target. And then I'm kind of like, you know, circling. And I've done that, you know, luckily, my shoulder's still together. My elbow's still together. Jiu-jitsu injuries, you know.
Oh yeah.
So it's been okay. But I've noticed I do have to start working on something better. I've gotten in the habit of when I do have like elbow pain or shoulder pain, I want them to push the bow forward. When I'm just target shooting, pushing the bow forward and not really pulling.
Yeah.
And I talked to a buddy of mine the other day, and he's like, "No, you need to be out and be able to draw back with your back arm." So I was like, well, I need to try that too.
And it's a little bit of a push and pull, especially once you get into, like, once you go and get into your anchor, like once you go, like I said, get that knuckle tucked in behind that ear and you get into your anchor point, you do want to be pushing and pulling softly. You don't want to be like reaming on the back wall and like flexing the cam. And that's just, it makes that 85% let off mod on that phase four, it makes it almost not even work, like it's useless at that point, pretty much. Like,
I just noticed I'm pushing a little more than I probably need to.
Yeah, and you're talking about just on the drawback?
Yeah, just on the draw. Just like, you know, if I'm from here and, you know, I'm resting it close, I'll pretty much separate from here. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
When a lot of people, they'll go ahead and point at their target, then the only movement they have is from back here, and then they lock out. So, but I mean, everybody's body's different. You know, I may do that and not feel stable.
Yeah.
My bow shoots with the way I do it.
And that's, so, dude, I mean, that's the best thing. It's same
shoots
with fishing.
It hits the target.
Like, it's the same thing with fishing. We've done a lot of episodes with this, talking about live scope and talking about different things. Archery is no different from that. Like, we had William Whetstone and Trandy in here one day last week. We did an episode with them, and it went live Monday, actually. Great episode. Like, have you watched that one?
Of course.
Okay. So, like, we broke down. We actually pulled up, had the iPad, and just screen shared to the TV, and was able to go, like, all right, here's how you catch, like, going into the fall. It's mid-August. Going into the fall, here's how you catch crappie. But not only here's how you catch them, here's how you locate them. And we pulled up. It was awesome.
Yes.
But we're talking about how each one of them do it with their live scope settings. They're completely different.
I know.
Like, I mean, you heard like crazy, crazy difference. Yeah. So what works for Trandy, Garmin Guru, that does not work for William. And and kind of same thing. And it was cool because I kind of found myself in the middle of both of them. I'm like, because I've learned from both of them, I kind of took a little bit from both and made it my own, and that's what works best for me.
Yeah, and that's what you have to do, and that's what you got to do. Same thing in jiu-jitsu.
Yeah.
I mean, there is like basics that you have to have, right? Basic things that probably has to be equivalent across the board. Like, let's just say gain.
Yeah.
Well, somebody has it at 65. That don't mean 65. There's probably a range you need to keep it at.
Yeah.
If it's too low, you're going to not see returns. If it's too high, it's going to be too much.
Blown out.
Yeah, blown out. So everything, you know, was probably around the same, I would guess. Was there anything that they were totally different on? Is that something I don't really remember?
Color limit was going to be pretty dang close to the same, which I think color limit for most people is going to be the same. When you get to like your the NVG, is that what it is?
TVG.
TVG. I'm thinking night vision.
I don't know. Tranny. NVGs. Tranny told me what it was. TVG? I don't remember.
Yeah, I think TVG is what it is. Anyhow, and then, of course, most people's gain, like you said, is really, I think, from like 67 to 72, most people are going to fall in that. I was at Darbon yesterday morning, had to film some stuff, and had my drone out flying. I was like, I got my jig pole. I'm just going to just put it in just there really quick. And I did. And I ended up being, after making a few small adjustments, I was on 72% and looking for crappie. And I'm normally, I don't have it that high. But for that particular day, that's what worked. But they were pretty close to the same on everything. But their gain, William definitely runs his hotter, which he's running LVS 32 and not the LVS 34 transducer.
Yeah, and that
makes a difference. Like that makes a big difference.
Yeah, and see, I got the 34. I was actually a Lowrance guy for a long time. Target, got the active target too. And there was nothing wrong with it, but it wasn't doing what I thought it should do for $4,000, you know. So I was freaking Trandy, man. He was like, you need to go Garmin, bro. I've been telling you. And finally I called him and was like, hey man, what do you think I should get? And he was like, the 34. I was like, what about screen? And, you know, he told me a couple screens. He's like, you need to get the 8612. And I'm like,
he's breaking the bank first time like, going out.
So I got the Echo Map Garmin.
The 126?
Yeah, the 126 Ultra, because they went on sale.
Yeah.
You know, they got the new Ultra 2s that are out, and I got that for like $1,500.
Mm-hmm. Bass Pro?
Shields.
Okay.
Shields. Got it at Shields. And which Bass Pro is actually about the same price now. And I actually just ordered a whole new system for a man yesterday. They got it $31.99 for a Garmin, the old one with the LVS 34. So it's $31.99. But they're probably going to run out of those pretty soon. That's why they're getting them on clearance. We're trying to get them out. But anyway, as I was saying, I got that 12-inch screen. Absolute great screen. I mean, it's great. You know, the resolution and everything is great.
Now, especially for the money.
Yeah, for the money. Now, if I just wanted to make sure I got that many more pixels and get like the 8612, which is like the mothership, you know, for the resolution wise, it doesn't make that big of a difference.
Yeah.
Is it going to make the fish jump in the boat?
Mm-mm.
So that was kind of where I was at. I was like, all right, Blake, just get this one and be happy. Because I got a problem. I like upgrading. I like getting it, testing it, upgrading.
Yeah.
I got an issue with that.
We're one and the same. It is a curse.
Yeah.
It is. I will bounce from one hobby to the next. And as soon as I get through with, and archery is the only thing I really stick with that, like, I stick with it year round.
Yeah.
Everything else, every other hobby I have, which is not a ton, if I can upgrade the gear or something, I like doing that kind of stuff. Yeah. It's fun.
Yeah. It's like, I'm bored with it. I need something different.
Yeah. I need something new. Need something different. Absolutely. That's why hunting season's so good.
We're dudes.
Most dudes are like that. Yeah. 8612 though. So the 8610, is it the 8610? That's the 10 inch version.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I really want the 8610, to put at my console. Cause right now I have a 9-inch, Lowrance at my console. And then up there on the bow, I have the 126 SV up there. Mm-hmm. And so that's all that I have. Just those two screens. I really want the 8610. I want to run it at the bow. I want to run it at the console and then get the MBT Marine, that 16-inch. Mm-hmm. I want that up there in the front. But you got to go to the 86 series. I think there's one
that
of the four.
Or a GPS map, I think. To
to link them.
Trandy would know.
Maybe the 12. Or I think you can go to like the 1222 maybe.
Yeah, yeah, that's the GPS map series, the 1222s.
Yeah, I don't remember if you can. I don't know if you can link the MBT Marine screens to the 1222s. You might, I don't know. Regardless, the 86 series would be awesome. Yeah. I would love to have it. Yeah. But yeah, you're right.
Comment on that, Trandy.
Yeah. Oh, comment. You know he is. Look, he's not even here, and he's typing his comment. Like, he's ready. Yeah. Like, right here, present time, not when this airs. Like, he already knows. He's just, his little brain waves are going off. He knows what he's going to say.
His ears are itching.
Yeah. He's going to be like, well, y'all, he's going to say, he's going to text both of us when it comes out. Y'all messed up and said so many wrong things.
Yeah, probably. Like,
that's why we have you here, Trandy. Old Garmin guru can set us straight. Yeah.
But hey, he's been great, man. He's helped me a lot. And I'm still learning that too, man. Like, in my fishing, I think I may have caught a bass using it. I don't know. I've caught crappie. But man, when we're looking at the screen, say like this right here is our screen. All right. I flip it in and I see my bait fall.
Yeah.
I don't sit there and watch the screen and go bite it. I can't do that. I use my live scope to find structure, find a life, find a bait fish, or find some type of separation. Like if I see a tree or a bush, oh, that looks like a fish blob. It looks, oh, look, it's moving. That is a fish. I try to determine what type of fish it is, and I'll just throw in the vicinity of it.
Yeah.
And then I just hope it bites. You know, and anytime I've caught big fish, like double digits, they're like, you probably live scoped it. I'm like, just because I got it on my boat don't mean I used it like for that. Like, I mean, it helped me probably find the structure. Sometimes I just flip out there and the 10 pounder's on it. And I just was throwing out backlash, you know?
Yeah.
But I wish I could be as good as some of these guys that I know that can just sit there and target them and beat them in the head till they bite. That, I mean, that takes work.
Well, and that's what people go. And if you're listening or if you're not listening, I don't care. But if people, I mean, I hope you're listening. I hope you're having a good time. But people that don't know how to use a live scope, they're the ones that are hating on it for the most part. I'm sure you have people that they understand the concept. They may used to have loved it and they're like, look, it made it too easy. I'm not doing it anymore. Those are few and far between. Yeah. I want to say it was the first 2-3 months after I had live scope that I was using it on the regular, at least once a week. I was going out, like at least on the weekend. Yeah. If I had some time during the day throughout the week, I would go. So at least once a week I was going and using it and then just watching videos at watching every Garmin guru video that there was on YouTube multiple times trying to learn it. It did not matter. When you go out there, it's a completely different ball game. Yeah. Like crappie, if you go and you're at Caney and there's 200 black crappie sitting there, you can drop your jig down and it's a good chance that if you know how to somewhat the orientation of it, you're probably going to catch a crappie.
Yeah.
Probably going to be a small one. Probably not going to be the big one to win you money. It's still an art to that.
Yeah.
But you ain't doing that on Darbone crappie. I can promise you they ain't doing that. But the bass though, it was months of me going out there and fishing with a live scope before I ever caught a bass. I would see them. I had no idea how to catch them. Like, really? I could see the fish, and I would throw something in there to them, and I'd throw it, finally get a reaction, and every time the reaction was them leaving. They didn't want anything to do with it for whatever reason. And so it's a lot harder than what people think it is.
Now it's fun being able to see them attack, and you know, it's when I had the first, I think it was the first active target, may have been the second one. Was in 3 foot of water on a flat on Bussy. It was a little flat on the north side. It's where, and it's usually loaded with crappie up there, and like where the lily pads start to grow. It was like late, I think it was like early summer, late spring. And it was getting toward the end of the day. So we were just goofing off. So I just put my head down. I said, oh, well, there's something swimming right below me. And we're in 3 foot of freaking water. So I have a little beaver bait. And I'm like, flip, and just dropped it down and was just jigging it vertically, and it would swim. I would hit it in the head and it would swim off. I'm like, I don't know what this is, but I hope I catch it. And I was just being an idiot, and probably about the 16th time I saw it go and just attack it, and I ripped it up, and it was a 3-pound bass I was hitting in the head the whole time. And that was on the active target. And my bud on the back of the boat, Jared, was like, just starts laughing. He's like, did you freaking just jig a bass out of the water? I was like, right below my troller motor. And then I did it one more time and caught a 2-pound crappie on a bass bait doing that.
On like a sweet beaver?
Yeah, sweet beaver.
Jeez.
Yeah, it was a stump I found on the active target. And you could tell it was a stump. It was just kind of here. And you could see the fish swimming in a circle around it real slow. And if you just kept your trolling motor still, it was so highly detailed of it swimming in circles. And I'm like, why do fish swim in circles? They're waiting on something.
Uh-huh.
You know, they're kind of like in a strike motor. If you can, like, if you see a big old deep tree, you see a fish and then it disappears. Just give it a second. Don't move your trolling motor.
It'll come back.
You'll see it reappear. And that's because they're swimming in circles. That on the Garmin, you can really tell when they're swimming in circles. And that's because they're waiting on bait fish to pass by that tree. or if they're nose up on the tree. I've learned that.
Talking about bass or crappie?
Bass.
Okay.
If they're nose up on a tree like this, so the camera can see, here's the tree. And it's like, why are they doing that? Because they're waiting for something to pass on each side so they can attack. Mm.
Well, I've seen crappie do that. I've never seen a bass, but crappie do that all the time. Like crappie, they'll go up and they dig their nose into the bark, if there's even bark on the structure or whatever.
Yeah.
They are nose up to it. And you got to drop that jig right down on, literally like on the, like you want it going down the structure, down the tree to hit them in the nose.
That's why, crappie, that's why when you flip it out there, you pull out that slack so it can vertically drop.
Just drop. Because
if not, it's going to come back down at an angle.
Them back to you.
It'll hit them in the tail instead of the head, so. See, and that's what I'm talking about. Like things like that, people can learn. You know, if they're watching this podcast, saying, "Oh, I heard this guy say this." You know, we're actually saying the same thing a lot of other people have said too, and we learned from that. So, you know, maybe one day I'll get on here and be like, "Hey, I'm the king of catching them on the TV screen," but I'm not gonna be.
Yeah, but you know, you get on them, and like, have you picked up some sponsors? I know you started repping some different brands.
I have Angler Tungsten. Timothy Manning's awesome guy. He's got an awesome tungsten company. Super cool dude. He's probably going to watch this because I'm going to send him the link. We got Favorite Rods. Favorite Rods is in not at the pro level. Not at the pro level. It's a junior staff pro. It's just like discounts repping for them. And then I had Shoal, which was a local guy here that had a certain type of bamboo shirts. Amazing. His company, he went on and closed it. I've had a few more, but Riot Baits is another one. They make good, like beaver style baits, my type of fishing.
Yeah.
But you know, I do it to, businesses that are trying to be up and coming. Mm-hmm. They got to get their name out there. Right. So they're going to pick anglers that maybe have more clicks or, somebody that's well known. They're like, well, we'd like you to represent our product. And they've been awesome people.
Yeah.
You know, especially the junior favorite rods junior program. They've actually been really cool. My video went big, this girl that works there, she's in the business department. I can't remember her name, Alicia or something. She emailed me and was like, that is hilarious. And she said, can we use your video to put on our page? I was like, yeah, of course.
Absolutely.
And just super awesome. And she was like, pick something out of the store that you're eyeballing. I said, you don't want me to do that. She's like, why? I was like, yeah, no, I'm going to do that because I've been eyeballing something. It's just I didn't want to buy it because it was real expensive. It was a $250 Andy Morgan flipping stick rod because I was looking for a favorite rod that was stout, that could handle, heavy stuff. And just from reviews and stuff I was reading, I was like, I want to try it. I just ain't gonna spend that money. Even though I get a discount, I'm not going to do it. And I said, yeah, I would. That's the one I'm looking at, but you don't have to send me anything, She said, no problem. We'll get it to you. Within like 2 days, they sent me that brand new rod, sent me some other stuff. And I'm like, man, I can go get hit in the gonads again.
All the time.
But I've been highly appreciative of that because they didn't have to do that.
Yeah.
But my one video on their page, we can go look it up, but it's hundreds of millions. So I probably brought them some revenue just on their social media.
Oh, I'm sure it was. I promise it was worth it. Even if their cost was $200, $250, I promise you, you sold some rods from that for them for sure.
Yeah, and they've been pretty cool, because if I post like pictures and stuff online, they're always commenting like fire emoji or something, mm-hmm. and people are like, dude, favorite rods is commenting your stuff. I'm like, they think it's like a big thing, but I'm like, yeah, I mean, they're cool people. They run business. They just got a big business.
Well, and that's what I was about to say. So a lot of times that's what it is. Like with me and the brands that I deal with, Three Spotted Dog, and even a few outside of them, the people that I deal with, they're just like me and you. Mm-hmm. They may just be operating at a very high capacity on a very big business, but they're still at the end of the day, they're just good old boys and girls. That's typically all they are. And so you can't be scared. Like anyone listening, man, dude, when I went and I got my first post shared by Matthews, like I was shooting the same old Matthews bow forever. And I'm like, it is my dream. Like I watch Chris B and Levi Morgan all the time. Yeah. And I think actually at the time, Levi Morgan was shooting for Elite, I think. But still, I was like, I just want Matthews to like reshare or just comment or like on something. That was my dream. Yeah. I was going to pass out if they did. And I know. So I was like, I don't want to tag them. I don't want to be that dude. And I went and took a really cool picture and tagged them in it. And anyhow, it kind of kicked off from there. It was legit. Awesome. But if you are on the fence, you're like, man, I want somebody to go and share my stuff or see it, just tag them in it. Most people do that anyways.
It ain't going to hurt nothing.
It ain't going to hurt anything. Yeah. And they, I promise you, they want you to tag favorite. They want you to tag them in their stuff. Matthews, Hoyt, Spotted Dog. If you, I promise you, I'm going to acknowledge you. If you go and you post something and tag Spotted Dog in it, I will acknowledge you. And I try, I've gotten lazy with it. I need to be better about going and resharing people's stuff. So if they go and, especially like their kills and people, like if they're out there and they kill a deer or turkey or a fish or whatever, like catch a fish and they tag Spotted Dog in it, I really try to go and reshare. But even some of the small things of them out in the yard practicing, I need to get better about resharing that to the stories.
I mean, we're all busy. I mean, if you go look at my page, I mean, honestly, you ain't going to see nothing fishing since June. Cause I've been busy with boat carpets and teaching jiu-jitsu and my kids and my family. I mean, I wish I could fish, you know, more, but you know, I think it's winding down. I'm getting ready for hunting season, and I will be crappie fishing this year, though. Yeah. I will be doing that.
Dude, let me tell you something. So, that's a new love that I found is crappie fishing.
The thump,
bruh. It's so cheesy saying that, and when I hear somebody, I saw a boat. Where was I? I saw a boat, it was a truck, and he said, feel that thump. I'm like, if that's not the most Joseph Cheek thing I've ever heard in my life.
Oh, Jojo.
Yeah, I was like, that is, like, I'm going to go out there and feel that thump. And I love you, Joe, but I was like, that's the most Joseph Cheek, or that's just the most, like, typical thing for just a good old down-to-earth redneck crappie fisherman to say is feel, and nothing's wrong with it, but it is so true. Like, I'm not going to put that bumper sticker on my, or the decal, you know, feel that thump or feel that thump because you're from Louisiana, you know.
Yeah.
I'm not putting that on there, but golly, it does feel good.
Yeah, man. I got a friend of mine, has been a friend of mine a long time. His name's Jared McBroom. He's going to be watching this. That dude got me into crappie fishing. Like, he always knew that I love bass fishing and everything, but he's like, man, I got to get you to Poverty Point. Got to get you on them Delhive crappies. And I'm like, all right, well, I've been to Poverty Point as a kid, you know, look at all that stuff. Like, no, we're going fishing. And anyway, I ain't gonna tell our secret spots, but he knows a certain spot there where there's a tree underwater, and he knows exactly how to maneuver the boat. And it's so funny, we were in this, I'll give you this tip. We were in a slough, certain depth of water, and it's us and a little bitty aluminum boat. It was my old aluminum boat, and we had to have 15 different aluminum boats all in the same slough because that's where all the crappie were. It was, and it's winter. It's probably November around Thanksgiving time where they really stack up and they pile up in like 18 foot of water. And Jared's like, let me have the trolling motor. So he gets up there. I go to the back and he's like, watch this. And he drifts to the left real slow. He says, get your jigs ready. Get them ready. Get them in the water. And then he clicks it and starts going slow back to the right. Boom, just starts ripping them. And these are freaking 2-pound white perch, every one that he's catching. And we went and limited out multiple days. And it's what's so funny about it. When we started catching them, all the other boats look up and they're just like, what are they doing? They start creeping toward us. Some will go, what color of head y'all got? And he's like, don't matter. Tricolor is what we got, but it don't matter. And we would catch all these fish. Nobody else is catching nothing. He's like, let's move and let them get some. We would move, circle out. They couldn't catch them. We would circle back in, start ripping them again. And it was
just boat control?
Boat control. This guy, he is so good. He can catch a fish out of a ditch. I mean, it's and it's the way the slope is, the way you bring the jig up over this fallen tree, and the way you bring it back. And no freaking live scope or active target was even there back then when we were doing that. I mean, we had a 2D Lowrance sonar that just showed our depth and where we could, but we couldn't see our line. We couldn't see our bait. I'll never forget that. But I got so hooked on crappie fishing because of that. And it was these Bobby Garland jigs, a little bitty, you know, we didn't use hair jigs or nothing. And we would sometimes tie two jigs. And the way we found our depth was like, if you're too deep, you're catching catfish or barfish.
Yeah.
You know, he's like, we need to come up. So, but yeah, shout out to him because he got me on that thump stuff, man. That's a
feel that thump, baby. Yeah. Feel that thump, boy. Let go fishing.
Yeah,
that's the worst South Louisiana Cajun accent.
Yeah, don't even get me trying to what they call it, a coon accent.
Yeah, no coon ass.
Yeah,
got that coon ass accent. Yeah, you gotta. It's tough. Look, I can make a roux. I can make a gumbo. I can cook, but I can't talk like them. I wish I could. So, but you know that's the thing. Like, you could go back then, and I feel like most people caught more fish. when you get the live scope, if you don't know it, a lot of people don't know it. And so, like, you're working all week, and you go out there on Saturday or Sunday after church or whatever trying to catch some fish. And when you go out there, it's almost like you get aggravated with it or whatever else. But if you just go and just fish and just, like you said, just use it as a tool to locate structure, look like, okay, well, there's some fish. I don't know what they are, but there's some. I plan on fishing that anyways. And here's this tree underwater I didn't know was there, whatever.
Yeah.
You'd probably have a lot more fun with it. And then it slowly come to you. But the good old days of catching crappie, like on the Bonnity, you know, 3 or 4 foot of water around some cypress trees. Man, golly, that stuff was fun.
I know. You know, and I have my times. Like when I go fishing, there's times it's like, I'm going to really use this today. I'm going to try it. It takes me like an hour. I'm like, I'm done looking at it. But I guess I'm going to have to dedicate that time to it and be like, look, this is what we're going to do. We're going to look at this and we're going to learn it. Yeah. I think that's what I got to do. And I'm a very patient person, but man, I guess when it gets around 100 degrees outside, I don't get
very. Yeah, that patience that goes out the window quick.
And that's the last time we went fishing. I didn't even take the cover off my Garmin. And Jared was on the back of the boat. He said, hey, man, you need to turn that on. I'm like, no. But he's like, you serious? I'm like, I ain't turning it on. I was just like, I mean, I wasn't even really mad at it. I was just like, I don't even feel like doing it. We're just going to fish the old school way. And I ended up taking the cover off and using it, but I don't think I looked down at it, but a couple of times, you know. And Trandy heard, you know, he's hearing it. Yeah, he would be like, it's just a waste of freaking electronics and thousands of dollars, you know. Yeah, I know, dude.
Maybe. That's all right. I know. Dude, look, the last time that I went, besides that 15 minutes on Darbon yesterday morning, the last time I was at, fishing, I was over in Lake Providence. Well, there was a farmer, he was pumping into the lake, pumping water. Mm-hmm. They were pumping out of a ditch. It essentially was pumping out of a canal into the lake. I don't know if they had run. I don't know what the deal was. Anyhow, there's water being moved over out of this culvert in Lake Providence on this. It's a private lake over there. And dude, let me tell you something. It got nasty. It got stupid. We caught, I don't know, 6, 7 fish, 5 fish, something like bass in a 4-hour window. And so I was like, we can fish until around noon or so. We got to leave. And dude, let me tell you something. We went, we found that water, and we started going and throwing some of those like little bandit crankbaits, like 3 to 4 foot. Yeah. Dude, we caught 74 fish, I think is what it was, or could have been, I don't know. I got the number on my phone. Could have been 60 something. I don't remember. But it was 60 or 70 fish. I got the number on my phone with a picture of all of them.
Yeah.
And we caught them, all those fish, in like 25, 30 minutes. It was insane.
That's fun.
That kind of stuff doesn't happen often. Yeah. And but they were just, I mean, it was fish from 0.5 pound to 3, 3.5 pounds, like crazy.
Yeah,
it was wild.
That's kind of like the old Lake Fort stories they tell you. Like, I think it's in around June when they start getting on them deep cranks, like them 6XDs, you know. Lee Livesey, I got a friend of mine that, you know, he used to go with him all the time. He's like, man, you don't know, you just don't know. Like, I had to sit down, my arms were hurting, so many 5-pound, 6-pound bass I was ripping from the 6XDs. And it was Lee was in the boat just telling him, like, hey, just throw over there. There's a stump over there. Lee knows Fork, man.
Mm.
So, that's a lot of fishing.
Yeah. Well, you have any trips or anything planned? Just like fishing, hunting, anything like that?
Nah, I'm just doing it. I'm just going on the fly, man. I mean, I would like to go catch, you know, a couple more bass before I kind of hang it up. But, you know,
it's getting to be about that time. So
do you just
bow hunt and like deer hunt, like rifle hunt and bow hunt, or you duck hunt? Or
I do both. I'm gonna put a lot of time in for bow hunting. October 1st. I'm already coughing. My job here is this.
I'm getting sick. I'm actually gonna back in closer to you. That way I can take off work too.
But no, I'm gonna try my best to be out there. And I am going to get my first bow kill this year. I am. You know, I'll go ahead and, you know, get on the board for that. Just want to become an all-around better hunter, because it is something that I just started back in the most recent years. I hunted a little bit when I was younger, got back into it, you know, when I could have a job that could actually afford hunting, because hunting is expensive.
Yeah, it definitely can be, man.
Yeah, so I try not to go too wild with it, you know. I'm going to do September 1st, going to plant a couple different plots. I got a couple different things I'm going to try. I'm just really trying to learn certain soil types and, you know, what type of fertilizers and stuff to use. I got some stuff called, what is it called?
Shady Patch, and then there's like a Clover Extreme.
Okay.
It's by Pure Whitetail. A friend of mine reps for them, and I'm going to try that in a few different spots.
Yeah.
Got a bag of Triple 13 I got yesterday, and just going to try things. Went and got a little tiller, a little handheld tiller.
You're ready to go.
Yeah, so I got a spot behind my house, I'm going to do, because I threw out the Shady Patch 2 years ago behind my house, and I didn't till up the ground good enough, and they say it's no till.
Yeah.
Well, I got a rake and was just like trying to scratch the surface. Well, it didn't freaking rain for like weeks. Mm-hmm. So those seeds just, I guess, went somewhere. It didn't sprout till after the season somehow. Those seeds survived.
Wow.
I don't know how, but I got pictures of July, about June, July, of a food plot that's like freaking 4 foot tall and luscious and green. Clover, the clover that has like the little white bud flowers on top, those type, arrow something clovers, radish, dude, it was everywhere. I had deer all summer long going out there eating it, and I was like, yeah, I got to really focus on making sure I till the ground right, fertilize it right, make sure it's damp, and I even got a big water tank with a battery sprayer, so I hooked up in the back of my four-wheeler, so I'm like, if it ain't gonna rain, I'm gonna go out there every day with my
and water and stuff, yeah.
So I'm just trying to get prepared, and because I know, and that's what I've learned. You know, we had some big deer on camera last year, and they were coming to artificial feed, or they were coming to supplemental feeds, you know, corn, rice bran. But the numbers we were seeing were coming to food plots. Well, when you feed artificially, what do you get? Hogs, bears. I don't want to feed corn this year. Yeah. I don't want to feed nothing flavored. So we're going to try to do more food plots and see if we can limit some of the hogs. And some of that, but we're going to see.
It does that every single time.
Yeah.
I've never hunted a spot like up in Kansas where we're going next week, going up there. We got food plots to plant, got feeders to fill, all the stuff. But I'm telling you, the last two deer that I killed up in Kansas, both of them were good deer, and I killed them in over a food plot both times. Never went to feed.
Really?
Well, the one, actually, take it back. The deer 2 years ago, he was walking, grazing to the food plot some. He went, he did stick his nose in the feeder just for a very brief second. Yeah. I mean, just enough to get a little dust on it. Yeah. And he went, took off walking, and I shot him over water at the backside of the food plot. It's most of the time they are going to go, and they're going to prefer some kind of crop, some kind of food over supplemental feed. The corn and rice bran, not saying they don't love, they won't eat it.
Yeah.
That does really good up around like Beekman and like where there's nothing, where they eat nothing but pine straw. That's where that stuff does really, really good.
Matter of fact, where I was talking about them, the big old buck was, you know, posted down below my stand. I couldn't get out of the stand. That was nothing but pine. It's a pine thicket.
Yeah.
Nothing but pine straw. And that's peanut butter rice bran.
Loved it.
They would lay there and eat it all for 3 to 4 days.
Yeah.
And then I'd bring another bag. It'd take them a day to get on it, and they did not leave. I had thousands of pictures.
Yeah.
But, I mean, I'm not hunting that spot no more. But, man, that was a pretty good spot. They got smart. They're like, this stupid guy's coming out here and feeding us really well.
Something's up.
So we're just going to come. Like if it was dark, at like legal shooting times ends at 6:07, 6:09, 6:10, they would come strolling through. I'm like,
they know. Pressure, man. Pressure, same way fish, same way people, same with deer. Pressure, it can alter the course a lot, especially like in a bedding area, like hunting a bedding area. Like if you're trying to kill a big buck and you're going in there for that deer, that's good. But hunting like over and over again, it can kind of change up the way the herd reacts.
And I think they caught on quick. And I was good. You know, I was real stealthy. They only blew at me one time because I accidentally hit the white light instead of the red light on my, I was like, oh, crap. And I heard it in the distance. Was stomping and everything.
Talking about getting angry. I'm getting hot and clammy. My hands are sweating over here now.
I know.
I hate hearing that.
Oh, I know, dude. Yeah, I was like, dadgummit. That's probably the big one.
Dude, I had a doe. This was in Kansas season before last, so 2 years ago. I was up there. Well, I went, and actually with my phase four is when I got it. So I went up there, and my new sight hadn't come in yet. And so I took the sight off of my V3X and put it on there. And I was like, all right, it's going to be pretty close to the same. Like, I know it's different, but I'm shooting the same arrow. It should be pretty close to the same. So I knew, like, all right, here's 20 yards on the tape. Here's where 20 yards actually is on on the phase four, and I already killed my buck with the other bow. And so like I was just doe hunting up in Kansas. That was it. Well, I was hunting over a feed, had a food plot kind of off. I wasn't hunting the food plot, but it was right here. But there's a little transition corridor that these deer were walking pretty heavily along a creek, hitting the feeder. And even if they didn't hit the feeder, they had to walk by through this little opening to get to the food plot if they were coming from this area. Well, doe, her and a little, it wasn't a yearling, but a big freaking onion-headed doe came. You know, her head was that long and ears, you know, looked like a dang donkey. Big, big-headed doe. She came in there, and I had a smaller doe with her, probably 1-2-year-old little yearling or whatever, or smaller doe. And I was like, all right, I'm about to smoke you. And so I go and I draw back, and there's, I think they were, I ranged them at 27 yards. And number one, it was just, I don't think it was that great of a shot, but also I went off my sight tape. And because I was like, I don't know, I went from a 29-inch V3X. I was shooting different arrows. So I went from a 29 V3X, which is going to shoot faster than the 33-inch phase four. The shorter axle to axle, it will shoot a little bit faster. But anyhow, it was off. So regardless, I shot at 27 yards, and I shot the actual tape, what the tape said, and it wasn't right because I didn't want to move the tape because I was going to put that back on my bow when the sight came in. I was just shooting does, so it didn't really matter. Well, it did. Anyhow, I shot.
Doe lives matter, bro.
Yeah, I missed her. I don't remember if I shot over her or under her. I don't even remember. But she ran out there. She ran out there to 91 yards and sat there and started blowing at me. And I got it on video. After a few minutes after a few minutes of her sitting there blowing it, it felt like eternity. And it probably was realistically for 45 seconds, I had my mind made up I was shooting her. So I pulled my phone out and I looked because I shoot the long range stuff. So I was like, all right. So I ranged at 91. I was like, all right, at 90 yards, this is where I need to aim on. And I don't remember what it was on my sight tape. Ain't got a clue. I dialed my sight tape to whatever the distance was supposed to be for 90 yards or 91 yards, and I drew back, and she was just, I drew back, and I took my time. I just pushed and pulled, and just surprised, just went off. The freaking nocturnal was just, I mean, it looked like a Viking, like archery shot, you know, like it's just blasting through the air, and it goes, and she, anyhow, it spined her and dropped her. But anyhow, killed her, 91 yards. Yep, 91. Wow. And she was actually dead. I got up there and she was dead. But yeah, dropped her in her tracks, 91 yards.
That is an awesome story.
Yeah, it was awesome. And got it on video too. So like it's on video.
You gotta send that to me.
I will. It's awesome.
Golly, that's a football field, dude.
Don't ask me to do it again. I can't hardly draw back on a deer these days. I get so nervous. But no, I mean, look, it really was just a lucky deal.
Yeah, if you're a doe, don't blow at Nolan. Yeah.
Nah, well, look, that
you ain't ever safe.
No, but dude, have you used nose jammer before?
Yeah, the vanilla smell.
Yeah, dude, that stuff. I'm telling you, I'm sold on that. I've been using it for a few years.
Yeah, it's I got a buddy of mine, Josh, that uses it, and we were sitting in the stand, and I was like, I think we got good wind. He's like, well, just in case.
Oh yeah.
Yep. And he kept spraying it, and I'm like, bro, stop! Smells like cotton candy out here. Like, stop! He's like, no, it'd be good. He sprays like half the can out there.
Yeah.
And then we had like, I don't know, 10, 12 deer show up. We could tell their nose was up there, like looking around, like something smells different.
But they don't know, like,
but they don't know what it was.
No, I've never been busted by one. Dude, I use the nose jammer deodorant. I use the nose jammer body wash. And I use that like to wash my hair with the body wash or the little bar of soap as well. And then I have the spray and I use that, the laundry detergent. Like this past year, I went all out with it.
Really?
I never got busted, but there was multiple times.
I have to try that. I got the, what's the red and gold stuff? It's just basic stuff.
Like Scent Killer Gold?
Yeah.
Yeah. I got some of that. Which is great. And that's awesome. And that's what I use, like the Scent Killer Gold spray. That's what I use. And it does. It works great. Yeah. Like I have the little ozone machine that I put up in the tree with me. Like, and I use all that, but I'm telling you, I've never used anything that I believe in as much as the nose jammer.
I tell you one product since we on a podcast talking about products. And no, I am in no way sponsored or anything by Pure Whitetail. My friend is a bad influence on me because he's always like, hey, bro, you want some of this? It's like a drug dealer.
Yeah.
And he said, man, this is the best scent killer on the market, scent cover. And it's Pure Whitetail Dirt Scent. It's a black spray bottle and it's dirt. Okay. Pick up dirt and smell it. They don't really have a smell, you don't think. I mean, it just, you know. No, you spray it on your body, you smell like dirt. I can't even explain it. So
is it like those wafers? Remember the little honeycomb looking wafers that people used to wear all the time hunting? You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, you get like cedar or some pine. Yeah. Yeah, it's obvious. You spray yourself and you're like, I smell like I'm out. It is really good. And the only reason I say it really good, not because to my nose, I've been so close to deer and they never got, I was actually like upwind from them, or the wind was blowing towards them. And I was like, they still don't know I'm here. And in that tree stand, I was sprayed down with that dirt scent and they were just chilling. And I was like, wow, I guess my scent cover's good.
Yeah.
And I've had a friend that's, you know, I hunted one spot. I've never got busted. And then my friend goes in the same ground blind, uses a different spray, and they blow at him all day long.
Wow.
Yeah. He's like, man, they freaking come out of the back. And they just, whoo. I was like, well, you didn't wash your pits, did you? Are you being too loud or something? You know, but I don't know. It's been good for me. But I wish I would have brought it and I would have said, smell this. Yeah. But
I'd love to.
Yeah, Pure Whitetail, need some discounts.
Yeah, come on, Pure Whitetail, hit us up. Get your supply in at Spotted Dog Sporting Goods.
Yeah, do y'all have Pure Whitetail over there?
I don't know. Huh. I ain't got a clue. Hmm. Is their logo, is it the head of like a big typical whitetail buck?
Yeah.
I feel like, I know I've seen their logo, but I don't know if they have it at the store. I'm not sure. They have some stuff called Cooter Juice.
Yes,
at the store.
Old Indian tricks.
Dude, let me tell you something.
Makes my wife go,
oh, me too, dude. So my Rambo bike last year, I went and I always go and spray it around the tires. And have you ridden an electric bike like a Rambo?
No, never have.
Don't. Because I'm telling you, you will go and you will sell your kids to go buy one. Like, not that they're that expensive, but like, it's hard to justify, you know, $2,000-$3,000 on an e-bike, especially when you can go buy one online for like $1,000 or $1,500. They're not the same. Everybody listening, I don't care if you buy a Rambo from Spotted Dog or you buy one, $1,000 one off Amazon, you're going to be highly disappointed with the cheaper version bikes. It's going to break. It's not going to have, the biggest thing is it's not going to have the power to go and do anything you want to do. Like, you can ride it on blacktop. It could be 1,000 watt that goes 100 miles. Mm-hmm. You get on some soft ground, you're not going anywhere. Like, you're going to be having to pedal and it's not going to be good. But I spray that Cooter Juice. I think this was the pink bottle. Mm-hmm. I don't remember the name of it, but
it's Cooter Juice. Rookum.
Yeah. Rookum. They have like a Rookum and then like a Seymour Deer or something.
Yeah. Seymour Deer. Those are the three.
The Cooter Juice, I think, is in the pink bottle, I think. Yeah, and Seymour Deer's in the yellow,
that's
maybe.
The heat.
Yeah. The heat. Yeah. Well, needless to say, it's built in my saddle bag. So I keep it in there in a Ziploc bag. And then I can go and I get it out and I spray it on my tire, my back tire on my Rambo bike. Yeah. That way, driving in, I just have a little bit of something for it. And I don't know if it works, but I think it does. And then once I get there, I'll go and I'll spray it on my tire one more time because I'll lay my bike up in Kansas or wherever. Yeah. As long as it's covered, I'm going to lay my bike at the base of the tree or pretty close to it, wherever there's cover. Mm. Why would I walk 200-300 yards if I don't have to? Like, if I can slip in and be scent free, not only is it scent free, I'm also being lazy. Like, if I don't have to go and walk forever carrying a saddle and a platform and camera gear, I'm not going to. If I can ride my bike and lay it down by a fallen tree 20 yards from my stand and it's covered up good, I'm going to. Well, the scent spray, the Cooter Juice, is spilled in my bag. And let me tell you something. Right now, it still smells like Cooter Juice.
Yeah, it ain't ever getting out.
It's never getting out. But that's some bad stuff, the Cooter Juice or the Seymour Deer or whatever it is.
I've actually, I got a success story. What's his name? Dan DeWitt? Is that no, it ain't. What's the man's name that's Old Indian Tricks? Is it Dan?
I don't know. Michael and Richard know him. Like, he actually wears like DeWitt, Indian maybe. Stuff all the time.
So he was like, please post your success stories on that. Well, I do have one about that. It was Primitive last year, and I was in Delhi and I was hunting a tripod. I've never seen this tripod. It's my friend's land that he let me and him go hunt it. He was like, so look, you take this lane, you walk 100 yards. If you've walked to the end, you walk too far. And he's like, there's a tripod that's over to the left off the lane. And I've got this little bitty red light that I'm just looking, trying to be real quiet. And I walked to the end of the lane. I said, dadgummit, I guess I missed it. So I'm texting him, trying to hide my phone. I'm like, dude, where is this tripod? I can't find it. He's like, it's to the left. I told you. So anyway, it was ducked back into the woods. He didn't tell me that. He told me it was right off the lane. It was ducked back a little bit. Finally found it. And what I did was I had a drag with that on it. And don't ask me why I put out Cooter Juice and Primitive. That's the beginning of the season. I was just to cover there, baby. Yeah, I was like, let me just spray a little bit and just try to cover something. But anyway, I drug that all the way down the lane. Had to turn around, drug it all the way back. And then I was like, oh, I passed it. So I drug it all up and down there. So anyway, I get up in this tripod. And I didn't spray, but just a little bit. And get up in the tripod, and I hear crunch, crunch. And it's still pitch black dark. Crunch. And then I hear a foot stomp. And then a crunch, crunch. And I hear that foot stomp. I said, oh, what is this? And I couldn't see. It gets right somewhere in front of me about 10, 15 yards.
Is it a deer?
It's a deer. I was like, oh, crap. And it's still dark. I said, you better go on. I don't know who it is. I was like, I know it couldn't have busted me. I was like, there's no way. You can hear it. You know how deer do. Mm-hmm. Stomp. They know something's up.
Right.
Walk down the lane. Shh. Was blowing again. And he blew, I don't know, probably 20 times.
Wow.
And my friend is 200, 250 yards that way. He texts me, what is that? He's like, kill it. I'm like, it's not daylight yet. He's like, shoot it. I hear it from here. I said, you can hear that thing? So anyway, it was a sun come up, and I'm looking around, and I don't see it no more. I was like, okay, maybe it went on. Maybe we're good. No, it made a circle. Come back, coming through the woods. And it was nose down all the way, that whole trail. His hocks were already dark on the back. Like, I don't know. This was Primitive. Like, why does Bucks have dark hocks already? Like, he's in rut. He was stupid. But he was a weird looking, like, he was messed up. Yeah. Like, he had, like, two on this side, three on this, four on, I think it was like a 5-point. He was stupid looking. And I texted him. I said, hey, this is a weird looking 5-point. He said, you need to kill it. He said, that one we've been trying to kill, he's messed up every year. And I was like, well, I don't want to kill that. And anyway, well, he turned around and he blew at me. So guess what?
You smacked him.
He's in my freezer. But I was like, man, that is crazy. That is nuts, because he was blowing, and then he just circled around. And I was like, he was following my scent line.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, it probably was that, because he had dark hocks and he stunk.
Yeah.
And I was like, man, this is real early. But Delhi's different. Delhi's, you never know over there.
You have multiple different, from Shreveport to Delhi and like Vicksburg in that area, there's multiple different ruts.
Yeah.
All different.
Yeah. And I could be telling a lie. It may not have been Primitive. It may have been the beginning of rifle season. It was somewhere at the beginning of the season.
It felt a little early to you, though.
It was pretty early. It was pretty early. Activity. It had just gotten cold.
Yeah.
And
shoot, that could be February here in Louisiana.
Yeah. I just remember it was kind of a cool. Yeah. I don't know. I get hit in the head a lot, so my dates may be messed up. But yeah, that was just crazy for me, you know, and, yeah, but I got his little old messed up looking rack in my shop just up on the mantle.
Nice. Dude, I got a picture. I'll show you really quick. I got a picture the other day. Let's see. I just took it. It's the only picture I got of this deer. But look at this thing. Tell me if that's the only picture I got of that deer. Tell me if that thing is not jacked. I mean, that looks like a non-typical out of a high fence.
Yeah, that's got some girth. I mean, that's velvet, of course, but I mean, it's...
This is a heavy deer. He's, what, 12 inches wide, 10, maybe 10 inches wide, but just like a twisted oak tree, just all kind of...
Yeah.
Like old cottonwood tree, just all kind of twisted and bent up. He's something's wrong with him, for sure.
That's different. I wish he could post this picture to see it, but it's like... I don't know, maybe 16 inches tall.
Yeah.
It's, 18 inches tall, maybe.
Yeah, I'll put the picture up on here, you can see. But that's the only picture I have. I haven't received. And he's walking away. But anyhow, it looks like it's just some weird looking thing. He looks nothing to be but like a 7-8 point maybe. But his tines, his beams, everything, it's just like
His spread.
Yeah.
His top two spreads about yay wide because it goes straight up.
Yep. Yeah. But anyhow, I just got a picture of him and I only got one picture. And so I'm looking forward to the season. Yeah. I'm ready. I mean, it's mid August. Mm-hmm. I'm ready. Everybody else is ready.
Yeah, I'm gonna be putting my cameras out in the next couple weeks. Go to a couple different spots and which I'm not running a high amount of cameras. Me and a bud of mine that hunt, he shares his with me, so he pays that plan and I can still see his pictures, and then you know, I pay for my plans for five cameras and he can share. So, I mean, it helps.
What cameras are they?
I run Tacticams.
Yeah, the Reveals. Dude, they're the best.
Like, yeah, they're pretty good.
Dude, they're so good. Like the new, the 3.0 Pros. Mm-hmm. Oh, my gosh.
Really?
Dude.
I was going to get one, but Amazon likes to email me and say, hey, this is 30% off today.
Yeah.
And it was the Tacticam XB with a free memory card for $103. Yeah.
And I have multiple, dude. I have
XBs
multiple
XBs.
Yeah, I have multiple
24
XBs.
24 megapixel cameras.
Yeah, they're good. They really are. They're not bad at all. A few of the things awesome about the 3.0 Pros, and 3.0s, I don't remember all the specs on those, but the 3.0 Pro, the new ones, no memory card. It's all internal.
Yeah.
Which is, that's not that big of a deal, but that's still a plus. That's still an advantage.
You can always clear them off your app.
Yeah, absolutely. So, I mean, or just put it on loop and it just rolls over them, you know. So you have that. The SIM card, it switches back and forth between carriers. So like if you go.
Best service.
Whichever one is best for the different carriers that it has, it's going to pick it automatically. Mm-hmm. Whereas like the XB, for example, you got to go. Not only do you have to swap out the SIM card from Verizon to AT&T or vice versa, you have to go in and be able to do that in the camera. You have to delete that camera off of your app and then add it back in as the new service provider.
Yeah.
And so you don't have to do it with that, which that's not that big of a deal, but that there's instead of low IR glow, there's zero glow. Like there's zero, I mean, it emits no IR glow at all.
Yeah.
I have no idea how that works, but it's a no glow.
It makes me wonder, deer can see that.
Oh yeah.
I mean, it's because I've seen them look directly at the camera, like directly at it, and go. Yeah. I was like, yeah, they're seeing that, and that was the low glow, like the 2.0 Reveal X's.
Yeah.
But the XBs, they're no glow.
Okay.
So, and that's another thing. I got a what was the other one? A SK. Remember the SK with the dual antennas?
It was one
of the first ones.
Okay.
It was a dual antenna SK.
I didn't have that one.
Yeah. I bought a pack and it was that with a lithium battery. I don't remember. It was like $170-something when I bought it. But that one is still cooking.
Yeah.
24 megapixel on that also. Great pictures. So I got those. I got a total of five.
Yeah.
I don't run much more than that. Because I want to keep my monthly cost kind of.
Yeah, I know, dude. Look, $13 a month for the first one and then $12 for everyone after that. It adds up. We have, I think five is all I have going in Kansas right now. Next week, we'll put up, we have several of the Tacticams and then the Covert Blackhawks as well.
Yeah.
When we go up there next week, by the time we leave, which this is Kansas, and it's not like we can go up there often. So, like, I want as much intel on that place as I can. Mm-hmm. And so we'll go and we'll put up, probably five, maybe six more reveals. So we'll have 8 to 10, 11, something like that, roughly up there reveals. Yeah. And then we'll have probably six covertes.
Yeah.
The Blackhawks that we'll put up as well. And
it does
get expensive, but that's 700 miles. That's hunting, like you said, it's hunting, but 700 miles away. I want to make sure I know what's coming. And the funny thing is the last two times that I went up there, or the last two deer that I've killed up there, I got a picture of one of them. It was like November 7th or 8th or something like that. No, it was November 6th. November 6th, we got a picture of this deer. Haven't seen him in a little while, and it happened the same thing as last year too. Got a picture of the deer, and me and my father-in-law were like, we're going to Kansas. So we went up there and killed the deer November 10th, and it was awesome. Killed him. And then last year, we didn't get a picture of this deer at all, like going up there. Like it was an ice storm rolling through. It was mid-December 17th. I don't remember, sometime mid-December. And it was ice storm, everything else. And we were slipping up there and we saw a break in the weather and we were getting no deer activity at all. Like we could look and like, okay, deer, they have to move. Like even if it's every 4 hours, they walk from me to you, they've got to move some, like no matter what, they've got to move. And we're like, there's multiple days, 2 or 3 days during this wintery mix, winter storm, that they are not moving. They're not hitting food plots. They're not hitting feed. Water's frozen over. We know that, so they're not coming there like to our water holes. They're about to have to move. Well, we saw a break coming in it, and sure enough, at 7 o'clock, it said there was going to be a break in the wintery mix, and it was going to stop. 7:15, I killed 160 some inch deer.
See, this is where you learn, guys. When there's a break, you got to be in your stand.
Yep.
Waiting in the tree, waiting.
Yep.
You know, I heard a guy talking about yesterday. Hey, if it's raining, good.
Yeah.
If you know it's going to stop in 3 to 4 hours, good.
Yeah.
Go get in your freaking tree.
Put your slicker suit on and get out there.
Get out there because the moment it stops, they're up and they're moving. Yep. And that is true.
And a lot of times.
Within the first 10 minutes.
Yeah. It was, like I said, it said at 7 o'clock. It's just going by hour, but it said at 7 o'clock it was going to stop. And that was the first stop in any kind of ice or snow or anything at all. Mm-hmm. Hail, anything. Like, it was, the winds were going to slow down. There's going to be a break in it for maybe an hour, if I remember correctly, and at 7 o'clock. And it was a few minutes after 7. I mean, you can't hold the weather people perfect, like to the T. They, you got to give them a little bit of grace. But shortly after 7, it stopped. And within I would say, a minute or 2 minutes, I started seeing deer moving. They may have been a good ways away. Kansas, wide open for the most part. There's some trees and stuff, but it's really wide open. I was seeing deer move, and anyhow, I drew back and shot that deer at 7:15.
Man.
Right there.
See, that's awesome. See, I gotta store that stuff right here. I got to remember that stuff.
Yeah.
Because we always want to go on the days where it's like, I don't really want to fight the elements, man. Like, really don't want to be, you know, you got to stick all that out.
Yeah.
You know?
They're deer. You can pattern deer. You absolutely can. But they're still animals, and they still have things that they have to go and do.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes you just got to go and brave the elements. You may not kill anything, but you definitely ain't going to kill it at the house.
Yeah.
And so as long as you're not endangering yourself or something, go hunt them.
Yeah, exactly. Deer don't have no social media.
Mm-mm.
They ain't got no hobbies other than just to eat, sleep, drink, and breed.
Yep.
I mean, that's it.
Yeah.
I mean, they don't sit there and plop on the couch and be stuck watching a TV show. No, like, they go lay down, they get up, meet.
Yep.
I mean,
back and forth.
Yep. So you just gotta catch them and be in the right area.
Yeah.
So,
well, have you gotten into saddle hunting yet?
No.
I've
got a friend that is.
So,
He's funny. I'm sorry. I'm laughing. I don't want to name drop him because he can be like, man, that's messed up. But he just got into saddle hunting. He's like, I want to do it. So he's got this, the release.
Yeah.
And this guy's, he was an SF in the military. So he knows how to rappel and do all this stuff. But he was like, man, it's been a while. I don't know. So this dude's, I'm practicing with my climber. I got a little summit open shot.
Yeah.
I'm climbing this oak tree, and he's five trees beside me, or about 5 feet away from me on another tree. And I'm like, all right. And he's already like 20 foot up. I'm like, dude. He says, yeah, this thing's kind of, it's stuck. And he's in the saddle.
He's got pressure on it.
Oh, dude. Pop. He shot down that tree. I was like, oh, bro, you okay? He's like, yeah, I got it. I'm good. And he's swinging.
So was he rappelling down?
Yeah, he had to figure out how to loop the slack on this side and open it.
But so
it
was like a mad rock or something, like another like rappelling device.
Yeah, it was. Gotcha. He had the whole latitude kit, and so he was like, "Oh, it's new. It's sticky. I'm gonna have to break this in because it was just real jerky." Yeah. But he got it. It took him a minute. But I was like, man, I don't think I want to saddle hunt. Look, that dude went from 20 foot to 5 foot, like,
pretty quick.
Yeah.
And you don't have to use the rappel system or anything. And I actually don't have it. I'm about to get it. Like, I'm about to order.
I want to try it. I want to try it and practice it.
I'll tell you this. So Corey Barr at Parrish Restaurant. So that's what I was with today. That's wherever my saddle over there. Before you got here, that's what I was doing. I was making a few modifications to that. But anyhow, and it's awesome. It's Cruiser XC saddle, in case anybody wondering. There's some really good ones, but that one is my favorite. It's awesome. It's Cruiser XC. It's legit, and it's incredible. But the new Grit series, Spotted Dog just got them in. And matter of fact, I just posted a picture of their new display and everything.
Mm-hmm.
For like, it's not entry level stuff, but getting in, like, where you buy a kit and everything's in there, and you're also not spending $1 million on it.
Yeah.
That Grit, Tethered is who makes it, but it's really good. regardless, we were out there hanging some stands just a bit ago. And yeah, that's what I told you. Like, I went out there. He's like, hey, I need some help real quick. So I got out there. I'm like, got my freaking J's on. And which I took them off. I had another pair of shoes in my car. Yes, so I had another pair of shoes in my car. So I went and put those on. But I was wearing this. Like, I'm sweaty. I stink and everything. But he saw what I did in that saddle. He's like, dude, let me get in that thing and check it out. And we did. And yeah. After that, he went, drove down to Spotted Dog and spent almost $1,000 on saddle stuff.
Hey.
Like, don't do it. And you don't have to ball out like that. Like, yeah. He saw how I had my stuff set up. He's like,
yeah,
I want it set up yeah. like this. Like,
I'm pretty sure I will do the saddle thing just to try it. I mean, I'm
it's
all
so
about
much
trying.
Fun.
Yeah. I'm going to, like I said, I'm a white belt. In the bow hunting.
Yeah.
Let me get my blue belt.
That's okay.
Maybe my purple belt, and then I'll do that. I got to get more comfortable in trees.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not necessarily afraid of heights, but I'm a short guy.
Yeah. Oh, me too. I'm not a...
so I'm like...
How tall are you?
5'6".
Okay. So I'm 5'8"-ish. Yeah. So like, yeah. There's not much of
so
a difference.
Getting up there, especially the beginning of bow season when I'm in my climber.
Yeah.
I still turn around really slow because my equilibrium is all jacked up. Yeah. I feel like I have to keep my back against the tree and move like this slow.
I've been getting choked out so many times.
I just always feel like I'm, but after I'm there and I sit for a little bit, I'm like, okay, I'm good. I'm comfortable. Yeah. But I have to get out of that. I've got to be more confident, you know? Yeah. But that just comes with time.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, the people at work towers changing light bulbs, I'm sure, you know, they once were like, ooh, yeah. Now they're just climb up there and be like,
not a problem at all.
Skirp, 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 skirp.
Yep. You know? That's all the work I want to do for a month.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's what you always hear. I'm like, man, I've never gotten that opportunity. I would take that. That'd be
what
fun.
Was it like $20,000 to change a light bulb on a pole?
Yeah.
Man.
Don't drop that thing, bro. That's an expensive light bulb.
I mean, I couldn't imagine. I got a friend that he did that before, but I don't think it was like that high stuff. He worked on some tower and did something. And he said, you don't know how windy it is until you get up that high. He's like, them, they do this. They literally do this. I said, I've been on top of a pine tree before about 18 foot up, and it was blowing. And I was like, but I was going way over.
Yeah.
Way over here, and then I hear it popping.
Then he's like, ooh, grip tight, hold on to that climber.
Yeah, I'm like, I ain't going nowhere.
Yeah, we're good.
I ain't going nowhere. I was like, unless it breaks. If it breaks here, I'm dead. If it breaks here, I'm dead. I'm sure everybody's had those thoughts before.
Oh, like, everybody has. Like, everybody's been in those trees.
Yeah, yeah, man. But yeah, the that I'll have to check out.
It's legit.
I'll probably start about 5 foot up and get used to that.
You need to start about 2 foot up, really. Like, that's the worst thing you do is go straight up there to, you know, 15 foot, 20 foot, whatever. That's the worst thing to do. Just go ahead, start on the ground.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, I mean, a lot of people listening, they're not from around here, but Spotted Dog, and you are, Spotted Dog, they have the saddle tree down there. It's on a big base, and it's literally like a 12 foot tall tree in their store that you can go, and it's already a platform. There's sticks, so you can try different platforms, different sticks.
Yeah.
You can climb on it. You can get up there and check different saddles.
Really?
You can do all of it.
Yep. Well, next time I'm over that way, I'm going to do that. Just please don't play Miley Cyrus Wrecking Ball while I'm doing this. Please don't do that.
Be swinging up through there. Yeah, we ain't going to do that.
Oh, man. Funny stuff. Funny stuff.
Well, dude, we've been rolling about an hour and a half. We both got wives we need to go home to.
Yeah.
This has been fun. We're absolutely going to do this again.
Yeah.
This was
no problem.
This is fun. I enjoy getting here and just shooting the bull. And we covered kind of everything. We talked some fishing, some hunting. And I think by this conversation, we're both ready to get in and kill some deer.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Definitely.
We'll catch some wintertime crappie, and we'll go kill some does.
That's right. We'll have more stories when I get back, I promise you.
Oh, yeah. Intro's going to be Miley Cyrus Wrecking Ball. We're going to come in. We're going to have it ready to go for you. Play that in the morning. When you go hit the mats, play a Wrecking Ball. Just walk in and just, like, start eyeballing everybody.
Yeah, yeah. They'll be like, yeah, we ain't rolling with that, dude.
Walk over there and just go over there and just like grab Chris, like just go back, grab him by the shoulder and be like, hey, Chris.
Oh, I do that anyway. I like to whisper in people's ear, like, this is what it feels like to die. And then I slowly sink in the choke. That's what Marcelo Garcia used to do back in the day. He would whisper in their ear and tell people that. I keep it playful in jiu-jitsu, though.
You gotta have fun with it.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Got to.
Big shout out to Chris Hill. Hopefully he'll get his first deer with a bow this year too.
Really?
Yeah, I think he's trying last year. I think it was his first one with his bow. He was trying last year and it didn't work out. It had bears mess him up a lot. So.
Oh, really?
Yep. So
they can go down there and snap their necks.
Yeah, I mean, the bears should be scared of him.
That's right.
That's a bad son of a gun, dude. Oh my gosh. Yeah.
Yeah, I love that dude. Chris, yeah. Chris, definitely love you, man.
Yeah, yeah. You're awesome. Much respect. Yeah. So all right, let's break this stuff down. Let's head to the house.
All right.
I appreciate you coming on.
Yeah.
All right, everybody. Spotted Dog, dude, broke my knuckle so strong. SpottedDogSportingGoods.com, free shipping over orders, $99 or more. So, Blake, a little short to court. I appreciate you coming on. So, tell people how they can find you if they need some carpet redone or they want to go fishing with you or how they find you on Instagram.
Well, short to court, SHORT. And I'm going to spell my last name, DECORTE. You can type that in on YouTube. You can type that in on Instagram, and I just click follow or subscribe on my YouTube.
Yeah.
You know, I don't push the social media that much. It's just there just for memories.
Yeah.
But yeah, I wouldn't mind having y'all watch some of my stuff.
It's some good stuff.
Yeah. I mean, it's just fun stuff. Yeah. It's fun stuff.
It's fun.
I'm going to start doing some more stuff next year on fishing, more tips and tricks type stuff.
Yeah.
I don't think people just like watching me catch fish. So I'm actually telling them how I'm doing it and just, and stuff like that. That's to help people.
Yeah, well, that's a good thing to do. It works out really good.
Yeah.
Next time you come on, so we'll get in and talk about some tips and tricks. And you laid out a few good things talking about some tips and tricks today on fishing and hunting. So yeah, we'll get you back on. We'll go into more of that.
Sweet.
All right. Appreciate you coming on. All right. Bye, everybody.
All right. Later.